Team Singapore does a lot of things well. They have smart ideas, they speak excellently, and their outfit coordination is impeccable. But what don't they do particularly well? We'd say that responds to our third argument, which really hurts me because we worked pretty hard on it. So why is that important? Because when we tell you that you affect state stability in the long run, when you have a lot more governmental turnover, that essentially negates their whole case. You cannot have long-term better representation. You cannot prevent power from being handed off to the wrong people. You do not truly give people the right to vote when you see this instability. All they tell you is regime change isn't a bad thing. We would disagree with those structural reasons. Don't guess that way. So, a few things to first, I'll really quickly discuss what we're supposed to be debating in this round, but then I'll dive into three core questions. First, which side is principally correct? Second, which side best helps the people in a state? And third, which side is best for long-term stability? So, really quickly on the framing. In this round, we should be discussing the difference between a benevolent dictatorship and a weak democracy. So, them trying to tell you about how all of our regimes are killing people all the time doesn't really engage with the word in the motion, benevolent. So sure, we can talk about the right to vote and democracy as a principle, but we ask them to also engage with the idea of benevolence. But furthermore, they have to tell you why it's defensible to have weak democracies, democracies that are often nascent and unstable, and why they'll still accrue the same benefits while they're defending like these super stable structures, which they don't actually illustrate the issue. So first core area in clash in today's round is the principle. What do they bring to you? The right to vote. As much as it hurts me as a red-blooded American to say this, I don't think the right to vote is the most important thing in this round. Why? Because as Aditya brings to you, the point of a right to vote is the ability to actualize policy. Like, that is why people vote in the first place. That's why Americans have complained so much about the Electoral College. And trust me, guys, we know. We tell you, you aren't able to achieve that end on their side of the house for a couple of reasons. First of all, because of weak democracies, you often have sham votes. They basically can see this when they tell you, yeah, Venezuela is a democracy. That's a place where we've seen a lot of sham elections. So sure, people have the right to vote. It's technically like free, but we don't think that actually happens. But second, if the state is so weak that it doesn't have the ability to do this, then again, that vote doesn't actually come into play. We think the ability of a state to provide for its people and to protect its people and make better policy is a lot more important than the principle of the right to vote. That is basically empty on its own when people are left starving, when they can't put food on the table, or when there's conflict within their borders. What do we bring to you? We bring to you the idea of the actual purpose of government. We tell you the real duty of a government is to do what's best for the people of the state. Practically, that means things like putting food on the table, means trying to avoid the fact that often people die in conflicts. We think things like the right to life, the ability to feed your children, are much more absolute than the values that they bring to you. That's why we think they're more important. So why are we winning on the principle at the end of the day? Because we propose a state's duty to actually defend its people and to defend their bodies and their livelihoods instead of a principle which they bring to you, which they give you examples in which they can't prove they actually uphold it, and weak democracies which can't actually enforce democratic systems. But that, the second core area of clash in today's round is who best protects the people in the state. So the first thing we bring to you in our second argument is the idea of improving the state, improving the stability of systems in the state. We bring to you three layers under this. The first is the idea of the economy. What do they say to our entire argument? You don't give us a mechanism. Actually, you do. We tell you, in a dictatorship, there's a swift decision-making apparatus. You don't have to jump through a lot of hoops, and often since you don't have high turnover within the governmental body, these decisions are stable. That's why we tell you, when South Korea was a dictatorship, it had its highest rate of economic growth because these countries are able to industrialize. We think that's pretty important. We think when people can put food on the table for their family, when government has enough money to provide services for the people, that's a lot more important than the supposed value of a weak democracy. But what's the next thing we bring to under this argument? The idea of government services themselves. We tell you, weak democracies are often very new and very young. That's why they're weak. So they often lack the resources and coordination in order to help their people. So we would say, for example, the fact that Somalia might be a democracy now, doesn't that weigh the fact that they don't have the state apparatus to prevent the piracy off their coast or the famine within their borders? We would say a government that has the ability to control such a problem, even if through authoritarianism, is a lot more beneficial than a government that might report democratic values but doesn't practically do this. But then the next thing we bring to you is the idea of cultural conflict. This is really important because they talk about minorities a lot, but they don't respond to we tell you that when you don't have a strong state apparatus that can control warring factions, you see a lot more oppression of minorities, you see a lot more violence. What do they bring to you? These long-term benefits. First is representation. We already told you, you can't actually actualize that when the government can't carry out representation and you often have sham elections. But then the next thing they bring to you is that people in authoritarian regimes hand off power. Yeah, people do that in democracies too. Like Donald Trump is having his daughter go to the G20 conference. We think that even in democracies, people have the ability to appoint other people unelected. This is not a trait that is unique to dictatorships. They bring you this argument about centralization that says, like, wow, you know, in a democracy, people are accountable. But again, we don't think that's inherently true, but it's hard to implement those accountability mechanisms. But as we tell you in our first argument, often dictators do take feedback because they really, really like being in control, and they don't like the instability that often comes when the people are upset. But what is the third core argument in today's round? It's the idea of stability in general. We bring to you an argument about state stability, which they neglect. But before I move on, go ahead.
Both in weak democracy and in benevolent dictatorship can backslide. But the international pressure not to backslide is much stronger for democracy.
I would disagree. I think it's a lot more common for weak democracies to backslide than strong dictatorships. Like, I don't know what you're talking about. The fact that you refuse to provide examples when we provide you a wealth of examples should really illustrate that point. But what do we tell you about state stability? We tell you you're much more likely to see regime change on their side of the house. Why? Because, well, you're more likely to see regime change in a democracy that's really weak and has no central apparatus, and there are also really no checks on the government, as you see within like a centralized decision-making system. So what do they tell you? Regime change really isn't that bad. We give you a couple of reasons that it is. First, it increases instability on face. When you have a weak government, you have a lot more uprisings and a lot more violence again, we would consider that very dangerous for the people and very unstable. We don't think there's absolutely any guarantee that you implement a better government in the long run, which is why in many parts of the world we see cycles and cycles of governments being overthrown, supposedly implementing democracies to no better end, which is also why we tell you that the second problem here is to often implement bad governments. What do they bring to you? An argument about minorities, which we agree is really important, but we don't think they protect them better at all. Firstly, because of the cultural conflict argument we bring to you, but second, because it's just not true. Like, both Sudan and South Sudan are supposedly presidential republics. We don't think either of them is particularly good at protecting minorities. In fact, we would argue they make this worse on their side of the house because they afford democracies this veneer of legitimacy, wherein they say, because you're a democracy, you're a lot better for the people. That is why there's less international pressure to improve the condition within their countries. There are more trade-offs on their side of the house, but they do nothing to improve them because being a democracy is good enough. So what do we give you? We give you benevolent dictatorships, which may not sound pretty, but actually create real benefits for their people. What do they defend? Weak democracies like Venezuela, like South Sudan, which we don't